Good evening, good afternoon, possibly even good morning, depending where you're joining us from. Welcome to Lacan in Scotland. It's an absolute delight this evening to have Eve Watson with us. Eve is the course director at the Freud Lacan Institute in Dublin, as well as being a practitioner in private practice, and the author of numerous exceedingly well-written and engaging papers. So it's a huge pleasure to have Eve with us tonight. I first met Eve, I think I was trying to work this out today, I think it was about 15 years ago I first met Eve at a seminar in Dublin where I was absolutely mesmerized by a paper she gave on Bracha-Ettinger. And it's lovely with Lacan in Scotland, we have this chance to reconnect with old friends and bring people into this forum and broadcast them out across the world. So it's a huge delight to have Eve here tonight, and I hope you all enjoy her talk. Eve, over to you.
Thank you so much, Calum. Thank you for that lovely introduction. And I am delighted to be joining you and Amanda and all in Lacan in Scotland, and to be amongst you all who are joining from places near and far. It is great, this way of working that we've developed since the pandemic started, a way of really not only staying in touch, but of doing some very good work. So congratulations to you and all in Lacan in Scotland for the excellent seminars over these last couple of years that have kept many of us going, I have to say. All credit to you. And in fact, we'll be seeing a bit of you in a couple of weeks when you come to Dublin, when you're going to come over and talk to us about the ethics of psychoanalysis, the ethics of Inishirin, the Banshees of Inishirin, in a couple of weeks' time. So much looking forward to that. But we're here this evening to talk about reevaluating spectatorship with the gaze and the drive from the case study to the film, or to film, that's how I've entitled it. I'm going to read my remarks. I have a couple of slides and I have a film clip at the end. So it'll be fun to see how all of these go. Hopefully that will all go smoothly. And I expect that my talk will take about 50, 55 minutes or so. So we'll see how it goes. And hopefully it will be of interest to you. And I understand there'll be time at the end for questions and comments and discussion, and hoping to hear from you, your thoughts on some of the things that you'll be hearing. The theorization of spectatorship has been essential to film theory and was crucial to its resurgence in the 1980s, 90s, and early 2000s. Considerations of spectatorship and the experience of viewing a film drew inspiration from the work of semiotician Roland Barthes, the cultural theorist Louis Althusser, and his elaboration of ideological interpolation, and the psychoanalyst Jacques Lacan, whose formulations of the mirror stage, the gaze, and the imaginary were important in theorizing film as a phantasmatic screen, as you find in the work of Christian Metz, Jean-Louis Baudry, and the feminist film scholarship of Laura Mulvey, Marianne Doan, and Jackie Stacey. Interest in the role and function of spectatorship by the contemporary psychoanalytic field has been in the hands of cultural and psychoanalytic theorists such as Slavoj Žižek, Todd McGowan, who was recently speaking at Lacan in Scotland, Joan Kopczek, and Jan Jagodzinski, among others, who use it to evaluate film text and culture as distinct to the analysis of spectatorship. As I will explore, spectatorship is, if we think about it, a component feature in psychoanalysis, in the presentation of case studies, clinical vignettes, textual presentations, all of which offer a window, a view into the private world of the analytic setting. In addition, there are film analyses by clinical psychoanalytic commentators such as Geneviève Morel, Anushka Grosse, Caroline Bainbridge, Andrew Samuels, and others whose analyses support their theoretical, conceptual, and clinical elaborations. And more recently, books by Pietro Bianchi and Calum yourself, through your series with of film and films and film experience, drawing specifically from the work of Lacan. One reason why the psychoanalytic film field has not taken up film analysis to a great extent may be as a response to the wayward application since the 1970s of concepts such as the gaze, mirror stage, and fantasy in support of film theory. In particular, the theorization of viewing and the experience of spectatorship. In addition to the use of Lacanian concepts for political, feminist, and left-leaning ends, and its use in exploring hidden meanings in film texts in ways that suggest a direct application of concepts. Zizek's popular book title, Looking Awry, while psychoanalytic, does, however, give the impression that a change of perspective is all that's needed to grasp a text more fully, to reveal something behind the scenes, behind the obvious. This wayward, or in some cases, misapplication of Lacan's formulations has tended to be, I think it's fair to say, looked down upon or poo-pooed within the Lacanian field as an outcome of applied psychoanalysis, with applied emphasized in a somewhat condescending manner. This waywardness of theoretical application is also perhaps why Lacanian theory has fallen out of favor in film and literary studies. The theory effectively came to a conceptual dead end. That there is a conceit or hidden meaning in a film is often why films are interesting and people are drawn to them. This is not dissimilar to how a case study is approached if we think about it. The listener wants to learn from the case, be enlightened about the work, and become more insightful. None of us would have gone past traineeship without the vitalization of case studies. I'd like to suggest that rather than setting aside these wayward applications of psychoanalysis and consigning them to the dustbin of history, we can learn from them in ways that not only help us to clarify Lacan's formulation of the gaze and the drive, but consider if these highlight aspects of contemporary culture and the process of ideological interpolation. But first, let's turn to Freud and begin there with the Freudian case study. And I've entitled this section, Looking for Freud or Looking at Freud's Writing. Spectatorship has always been intrinsic to psychoanalysis from its inception. With the publication of the studies in Hysteria, 1894, which is the effective launching of psychoanalysis, readers were offered a ringside seat into the cases of Anna O, Emmy von N, Lucy R, Katerina, and Elizabeth von R. This was the same year, coincidentally, that the Lumiere brothers first presented a moving projection to an audience in Paris in 1895 using a cinematograph, which was a camera, a projector, and a film printer all in one. Before considering what kind of spectating Freud was aiming at in his presentation of the five cases in his studies, the role of spectatorship had already been elemental to Freud's five-month attendance from October 1885 to March 1886 at Jean-Martin Charcot's clinic in the Salpêtrière Hospital in Paris. There, hysteria was not merely a visible phenomenon, but one that demonstrated itself admirably to the medical gaze. In the hospital's great amphitheater, Charcot impressively held forth in weekly consultation externe, which comprised examinations of especially puzzling or difficult cases of hysteria to a rapt audience of assistants and students. And this was captured by André Brulé's famous lithograph, in which the gaze of Charcot and all present is centered on a female patient languishing in a semi-conscious state, supported by one of the doctors. Freud brought a copy of this lithograph from home from Paris, And his daughter, Anna, reported that her father often looked at this picture and seemed to happily recollect his time there. Freud was, we could say, dazzled by the brilliant and independently minded Charcot, and his luminous lectures propelled Freud away from the laboratory and towards psychology. Freud, in his own telling, was able at this time, quote, to see for himself, end quote, and examine a long series of patients in addition to engaging in lively discussions about hysteria with Charcot and colleagues. And that's a letter written to Martha from 1886. A feature that Freud was especially drawn to, according to Peter Gay, was Charcot's detailed accounts of his trains of thought and his frankness about his doubts and hesitations. As noted by Peter Gay, this mode of including doubt and uncertainty reduced the distance between teacher and pupil and was an approach adopted by Freud for which he would become synonymous. So what was Freud aiming at in preferring to the reader a veritable ringside seat into the mind of the patient and the work of the doctor in the studies on hysteria? An important clue is given to us in Freud's own review of his process of writing the case studies. The cases, he writes, in the discussion section of Elizabeth von R, read, quote, like short stories, end quote. The German word that he actually used was novella. And Strachey's translation does not quite do justice to what this encompasses. Novella in German is similar to its English definition. It invokes a narrative form of writing, typically prosaic, and is a format usually reserved for fiction. The cases stand out, as many of you will have read them, I'm sure. The cases stand out both for their individuality and differences to each other, and each one is an engaging read in its style and approach, as is typical of a novella. To this, the reader is not allowed to settle into an easy or relaxed state, as effort is required to follow along. As Freud is documenting his evolving method, a movement away from Breuer's cathartic method to that of free association as the principal psychoanalytic method. All of this makes it difficult to simply voyeuristically enjoy the studies, because as a type of novella, the reader is witness to an unfolding story as well as evolving method. This idea of a work continually in progress characterizes all of the subsequent case studies, the six major ones: Dora, Little Hans, Schreiber, the Ratman, the Wolfman, the Young Homosexual Woman. Cases to which Freud returned to time and time again, applying flexible definitions and indicating in each a general lack of unity. This is especially so, you could say, in the cases of Dora and the Wolfman. They are fragmentary rather than comprehensive nature, and of a writer's journey that was constantly in a state of renewal and at times wonderment. Let's take the Dora case. There, Freud begins the prefatory remarks by restating the impossibility of a case study to completely elucidate a case, and how the psychoanalyst is caught between a duty to transmit case material and protecting the patient from discovery. He goes on to describe three kinds of incompleteness of the case study. First, as with an archaeologist, the analyst is only able to go as far as an excavation has revealed. Second, it is not interpretation that is set out, but the results of an interpretation. And finally, no single case study can provide the answers to all of the questions at stake. Patrick Mahoney, who has written extensively on several of Freud's case studies, including Dora and the Ratman, observes that Freud's style, and I'm quoting Mahoney here, quote, remains perennially fresh, more lively and engaging than many subsequent psychoanalytic treatises, end quote. And he goes on to argue that Freud's discourse combines a style that involves a way of writing about psychoanalysis, which Mahoney describes as exploratory writing, where he writes in order to discover what he's thinking and share it with the reader, as well as containing findings he dogmatically supports and then sometimes later disavows. Mahony calls this a combination of, on the one hand, a genetic or historical style, which includes Freud's unconscious and is reflective of the psychoanalytic process, and on the other, a dogmatic style to which he ascribes five characteristics, which he draws from Freud himself in An Outline of Psychoanalysis. In 1940, one of Freud's concluding lectures in psychoanalysis. His dogmatic style aims to expound rather than convince. Its procedure is deductive as it begins by stating its conclusions. The procedure makes demands on the reader's attention. The tenets are presented in the most compressed form, and the reader gains an impression of a self-contained whole. By contrast, Freud's genetic discourse is an expository process where he is educating the reader, developing their self-awareness, following an investigative path which builds upon psychoanalytic ideas already propounded, not just to persuade the reader, but in order to encourage associations and reenactions, not just of the readers, but also the writers. And Freud includes a sense of an ongoing exploratory process which encourages and facilitates the reader's associative and critical faculties, as he does, for example, in discussion with his lay listener, where he engages with a person who is skeptical of psychoanalysis. And that's a very, very worthwhile read. It's a very, very obvious example of this. This combination of historical or genetic and dogmatic styles is quintessentially Freud's own, borrowed in part from Charcot. It inflects most of Freud's writing, especially the case studies, and puts the reader to work, engaging them at different levels and in different registers in the Lacanian sense. There is the imaginary register of completeness, as in, aha, I have it, I know what this case is about. And then there is a symbolic register in which the significant and granular aspects of the case are open to consideration and testing in relation to the theory and concepts, and where there's a working through and interpretation of the text. The effective register of the real, the register of the real is to refer to something beyond the text, which can't be reached, but is nonetheless vitally important. Freud thus doesn't allow for passive spectatorship, and as we all know, neither does Lacan. And for those of you, those of us who have read the case studies, I think you'll be able to relate to these different registers that have been activated in reading the cases. I'd like to go on now and explore Lacan's concept of the gaze as a further complexification of the dimension of looking and spectating. Now, Lacan's concept of the gaze is primarily developed in his 11th seminar, The Four Fundamental Concepts of Psychoanalysis, where he specifies the fundamentals as the drive, repetition, the unconscious, and transference. However, before we get into the gaze, a quick reminder that it was preceded by his elaboration of the mirror phase and his important supplement to the mirror phase, the optical schema, formulated in 1954. It's available in his first seminar. And again in 1960 in remarks to Daniel Lagash. And it's also to be found at the very end of the seminar on transference. This is the optical schema. The mirror stage emphasizes the mirror image in the formation of the ego and the installation of imaginary supports of the eye. That's a very, very brief outline of the mirror phase. We recall that in the mirror phase, the child's image is taken as a model for its future identifications, but the image is a fiction in that it conceals the child's lack of motor coordination and the fragmentation of the drives. It's not that the mother and child engage in a mirroring process, but that the mirror image is given by the mother, whose assent is necessary to the child's assumption of the mirror image. With the optical schema, and you, the mirror stage was formulated, presented by Lacan at the International Psychoanalytic Association conference in Marienbad in 1936, rather unsuccessfully. And he returned to it again in 1949. A few years later, we have the optical schema, 1954 specifically. And with that, we can say that Lacan adds an important element to the mirror phase by modeling, using this schema, a pre-specular image of the body, which serves as a precursor to the psychic views, and it also refined the elemental role of the other, the big other, in the process of ego formation. And I'm going to bring up now a slide of that. So if you could just bear with me for just a moment while I do that, because I think it's important that you see it. So just bear with me for just a second here. Okay. Just move a few things around here now on my screen. I presume you can see this. You can see this?
Yes.
Okay. You're looking at the simple version of the optical schema. Okay, good. I'm going to leave it like that. Okay, and continue with my notes here. Maybe just to switch to the more complete version of the schema here, of the two mirrors. Okay. Okay, so just I'll probably toggle back and forth between the two of them as I read. Okay. Now, in the placing of the subject before a mirror, which has a space behind it, the optical schema demonstrates the imprint of an image in the drive-ridden protean subject's chaotic reality before it can be seen, indicating that the mirror does not reflect an image that exists in reality, but gives an image where before there was not one. We can pose this in terms of the interactions between mother and infant and the power of the mother's look to the infant before it can distinguish objects in the world, including the mother herself, this being prior to the mother being recognized as separate and distinguishable from the breast. The infant turns to the other, the big other, which is the locus of the signifier. And the other's look is linked to the baby's proprioceptive sensations, so discomfort, bodily jouissance, the infant's own body and drives. This is how the drives and demand are imbricated and come to settle on the body's openings and orifices and their separable objects. The infant's demand for the mother's looking, her regard, to pick up on the French word used by Lacan, and I will come back to this, it's important as demand is the domain of the drives. The drive, as Lacan frequently states, is demand. And this regard, this look, is a precursor to articulated demand that will eventually culminate in the superego. In this iteration of the schema that you're looking at, it is the field of the other, which is coincident with the plane mirror. You see, there's two mirrors here on the schema as you look at it. I think you can see my arrow moving. I think you can see that. I'm moving my, you see the plane mirror, okay? And there's a concave mirror here. I see the word concave has been cut off here. So there's two. So this represents the, I suppose, the inchoate big other, okay? The plane mirror. and here in this in the apparatus itself. And this is absolutely essential, that the subject is in the apparatus itself. This is the real vase, which is always outside of the specular or the visual field. What is seen are the flowers, but not the container of the flowers. This being absolutely necessary. And I, as you're, if you haven't grasped it already, you will. I'm no expert on these optical schema, but what I think they illustrate very, very well beyond the mirror phase is the importance of the big other. And I think that's absolutely crucial, and how we can link the idea that there is a pre-specular image of the body that precedes the specular image, the mirror image of the body. And this is an important elaboration at this point. So I'll read on a little bit more here. So the concave mirror, which comes to refract the mother's look, this plain mirror, it refracts the mother's look, as, and Cormac Gallagher describes this in an important paper on the optical schema from the letter. It's entitled "The Historical Development and Clinical Implications of Jacques Lacan's Optical Schema," written with Mary Darby. I highly recommend it. It's as if this is like looking through a shop window, as Cormac Gallagher puts it, this plain mirror in which you can see there's something on the other side, but it is distorted and not easily accessible. This is the space before the unifying image, in which there is a beyond, a real image that can't be seen. And this is how Lacan ensures there's not an utter dependence on the big other and its code and signifying locus. There's a beyond which opens out onto the desire of the other. And as Lacan puts it in his seminar on anxiety, it is how the image in the mirror comes at some point to stop looking back at us. And if I just go back to this is what would happen. This is the paranoid version of the schema. This is how the image would continue to look back at us. This is a simple version of it. There's no symbolic mediation here of the object between the observer and the object. Okay. The schema thus maps the role of the registers of the real, imaginary, and symbolic in the structuring of the subject. Sorry, I'm organizing myself here. I can sort of only do one thing at once. Okay, good. The schema thus maps the role of the registers of the real, imaginary, and symbolic in the structuring of reality, which involves a necessary distortion of the real. I can't claim to fully understand the intricate workings of the optical schema, and I don't, but it is significant in challenging commonplace assumptions about the objective nature of the visual field. The visual field is a distortion of reality, or as Lacan will later specify, the distortion of the real. In the schema, the real flowers in the vase are represented by an optical illusion indicated by the two mirrors. It problematizes an equivalence between the process of seeing and the object or reality that is perceived. And Lacan is clearly aiming at uncritical assumptions in psychoanalysis about the unity of human perception. The optical schema, therefore, is a critique not only of ego psychology, dominant in psychoanalysis by the 50s, and the unitary role it accords to the ego functions, and also looking to go beyond, for example, Freud's egg schema, that egg schema from the ego and the id, which can be read as emphasizing the role of the ego as having a dominating function in the psychic apparatus. But it also aims, we could say, at the historical linking of presence to consciousness, as propounded, for example, by Descartes, but connections there to Hegel, which Derrida famously took to task in his text, The Scene of Writing. This linking of presence to consciousness continues to be a force and underpins the medical gaze, which typically requires observation of an object for it to exist. With the first model of the optical schema, the form of the ego is given and in being schematized as an optical metaphor, it underscores the idea that the structuring and an imaginary function of geometrical perspective of the field of vision is vastly inferior to the depth of psychic life. Lacan's use of an optical instrument not only undermines the idea that optics serve as the basis for understanding perceptual phenomena, but it also indicates the subjective organization of the imaginary as dependent on the symbolic. And this is how the schema builds on the mirror phase elaboration, which fell short of circumscribing the role of the big other in the process of imaging a body self. The schema links the psyche and the phenomenon of perception such that Freud's other scene can be apprehended not in terms of its accordance with external reality, but as psychical reality, which is intersubjectively structured and is primarily enacted via dreams and the transference, which draw on variations of the O object, especially the gaze and the voice. And if we think about it, the dreamer is a spectator to their dream. And the kind of spectator they are depends on how they relate to the dream material and related associative work. The inherent drive reality of a dream seeks satisfaction. And that is why dreams have a curiously pleasurable aspect to them, even when they are disturbing. The optical schema is the logical precursor to Lacan's formulation of the gaze. The gaze corresponds to the O object. I'm saying that I suppose that's the English way of referring to le petit objet A, as Lacan defined it, the lost object, the object cause of desire, and the object around which the drives endlessly circulate. As an O object, which is therefore a real object, the kind of looking the gaze implies is irreducible to metaphor and any symbolic mediation of the combinatory. It is an unassimilated other that looks upon the drive-ridden baby whose psychic structure must develop defenses against this big other that looks, and I should add, also addresses via the voice. In this sense, the visual field with its geometrical perspective is a defense against the gaze. It is a refraction of the gaze through the organization of the three registers with the dominance of the imaginary register. And Lacan privileges two O objects, you could say, the voice and the gaze, which I think gives cinema, which typically combines both sound and image, its special place in our enjoying world. So I'm going to move on now and say something more specific about the gaze. Dan Collins commented in a talk last year at Austin Riggs that. And it will be in a forthcoming article. He commented about the gaze and suggests that a translation of the term le regard, which is Lacan's term, as the look may be helpful, as distinct to the gaze. It may be helpful in distinguishing the Lacanian gaze from other variations, such as Sartre's gaze and those of film studies. And it also, if I may continue to borrow from Dan, offers us more. As in, a look is not as easy to pin down as the act or activity of gazing. The gaze in Sartre's famous vignette of the voyeur at the keyhole is objective and is linked to the owner of the footsteps, heard as the protagonist is peering through the keyhole. Specifying the gaze in Lacanian terms as the look may be helpful because the gaze has become conceptually embedded in other disciplines that have drawn from but differ to Lacan's concept. And this may offer, and they offer another route to specifying spectatorship. But first, let us specify the gaze as a real object. What, in fact, is the gaze? It is the business of being looked at. It is not actively experienced, but passively experienced, and it produces anxiety and disturbance. As Lacan puts it, and I'm going to quote from seminar 11, I am looked at, that is to say, I am a picture. End quote. In his seminar the previous year on anxiety, Lacan specifies the eye as a mirror that organizes the world into space. It's not a mirror of the world in its apparently natural, but it is not a mirror of the world in its apparently natural relationship to what appears to be an already out there real world. What is visually perceived doesn't reflect the world, but rather organizes a spatial relationship to the world on behalf of the subject. What is determinative of this is a look, the gaze, which is outside. It is outside of the subject. It is anonymous and non-specular. Paintings, you could say, go some way to capturing this. They tend to have a vanishing point in their representational space where all of the parallels seem to meet and make a hole in the surface. And according to Alain Vanier, this enables the picture within the limits of its frame to refer to infinity and a continuity of space. There's always an absence, a hole in a picture, which is correlative to a blind spot in vision. And this is where Hans Holbein puts the anamorphosis, a strange deformed object, in his famous painting of the ambassadors, which hangs in the National Gallery in London. I got to see it a couple of weeks ago and visit it again. In order to be able to see, the viewer has to be able to put themselves into the picture frame. And in doing this, the spectator will not be able to see the other objects in the picture. The visual field is divided between being able to see the anamorphic skull and the rest of the painting. In cinematic terms, this is eminent. This kind of effect is eminent, for example, in the plug hole of the famous shower scene in Psycho, in the planet Solaris in the film of the same name, in the ground chasm that opens up in 2015's A Monster Calls, in the darkness of Buffalo Bill's cavern in The Silence of the Lambs, and arguably in the red coat of the little girl in Schindler's List. The result of being looked at in this way is the subject, or the viewer, spectator, is unmoored and loses their place. Symbolic and imaginary supports fall away, and the subject, the spectator, is in the picture. This disturbance is also a clinical phenomenon, and the most well-known is the instance of the disturbing gaze of the wolves in The Wolfman's Dream. By contrast, to just take a moment to contrast this with the work, very influential work in feminist film theory, Laura Mulvey in the 1980s and 1990s explores visual pleasure in terms of spectators' voyeuristic fantasies, scopophilia, and the pleasure of being looked at. She argues the women on screen represent castration and activate voyeuristic and fetishistic mechanisms to circumvent this threat as a result of the shifting emphasis of the look. She argues that cinema builds upon how women are looked at as desirable objects. Similar to film theorist Christian Metz, who takes up the screen as a mirror in a straightforward way that reflects its spectatorship and culture, and onto which the audience projects its wishes and fantasies, Mulvey writes, quote, the position of spectators in the cinema is blatantly one of repression of their exhibitionism and projection of the unrepressed desire onto the performer, end quote. This does not seem to be picking up on Freud's analysis of psychopathic characters on stage, where he says the pleasure principle is at work in watching artistic play, and imitation of tragedy and painful experiences can be felt by them as highly enjoyable. And it's far from the idea of the gaze. Metz also takes a straightforward approach to the process of looking in designating the spectator as not only the only one doing the perceiving, but as all perceiving, and the entire constitution of what he refers to as the signifiers of the cinema is based on mirror effects organized in a chain in support of its symbolic structuring. The experience of cinema thus is altogether imaginary because it's fictional, like theater, but absent from the screen, unlike theater. We can pretend for 2 hours that there's no lack in the voyeuristic experience of viewing, an active or passive experience of viewing, and there's active or passive object identification with characters. What distinguishes the filmscape from that of dreams is, according to Metz, and I'm going to quote one last time, filmic perception is a real perception. In other words, it really is a perception. It's not reducible to internal psychical process, end quote. While the process Metz has in mind is the dream work specified by Freud, the overall effect of this is to elide the role of the psyche, or as we might specify, the role of desire in spectatorship, in spite of drawing from psychoanalytic conceptualizations. Returning briefly to Mulvey, pleasure, she contends, is understood on the basis of looking at another person as a desirable or eroticized object, and the screen functions as a mirror in structuring a fascination strong enough to allow a temporary loss of ego in misrecognition, while also reinforcing it through identification. This, Mulvey adds, is nostalgically reminiscent of the pre-subjective moment of image recognition. For her, the gaze is formulated in terms of the male gaze, which projects its fantasy of men equaling active onto and projecting that onto the woman. She writes, in their traditional exhibitionistic role, women are simultaneously looked at and displayed, with their appearance coded for strong visual and erotic impact, so they can be said to connote to be looked at-ness. Women displayed as sexual object is the leitmotif of erotic spectacle from pinups to striptease, from Ziegfeld to busy Berkeley. She holds the look and plays signifies male desire. She gives the example of the coinciding of two gazes in the showgirl character as erotic object for the screen characters and as erotic object for the spectator in the audience. The look in this way is the material representation of the male ego for which women are indispensable, and she distinguishes two separate material dimensions, that of the world and that of the object. And as I indicated earlier, this approach, while very interesting and very new for its time, it ultimately had a time limit. It could only go so far. And it's very much rooted, I think, as Metz is, in an imaginary version of the look, which, you know, does exist, of course, but Lacan's formulation of the gaze is as a real object. So I'm going to briefly turn to that now. Against this is the Lacanian object as cause, as that object in dreams we can never catch up with. The object, the subject, is always chasing, getting closer and closer to it, but never catching it. Subject and object are interlinked and imbricated by virtue of a distance preserved between them, not similarity, but distance, which is also the drive in its endless circuit around the impossible to reach object. The intersubjective is therefore not a subject and another subject or object, but the relation of the subject to the object. Mulvey and Metz's work give the impression of mastery over the image, as in the viewer relates to the image and they do so as in a mirror. No wonder psychoanalysis has fallen out of favor in film studies, with this kind of reductionism of women to mere objects of spectatorship, as in the male gaze, which is inevitable with this kind of reading of the gaze in terms of a geometrical perspective of seeing and not seeing, and as support for modes of identification. Hilary Neroni describes this kind of feminist appropriation of psychoanalysis as a tool for criticizing and reconceiving film practice as revolutionary for its time, but limiting. The problem, she sees it, is that it viewed psychoanalysis as prescriptive rather than investigative, wrenching it out of its domain for a project of feminist filmic practice rather than as a tool for discovering a feminist filmic practice that would allow for experimentation and flexibility. And we're very much, I think, in the second of Freud's discursive frameworks, which is the more masterful one, and the consequences of that. Joan Kopczyk, in a number of more recent works, has opened up the gaze significantly beyond Mulvey's static camera to conceive of it as the stain in the picture looking back at the viewer. In Read My Desire, she offers a more investigative reading in her use of the gaze as a potential screen in every mirror that has the potential to disrupt the subject's sense of mastery. At the moment the gaze is discerned, the image and the entire visual field takes on a terrifying alterity. In the image becoming a screen, this causes the subject to confront it with a question about what is being concealed. To properly specify the Lacanian gaze is to restore the intertwining of unconscious and unknown processes in spectatorship, as well as points in a text, be it that of the analysand's speech or the filmic text, in which narrative coherence is broken and something else is rendered, such that the analysand or spectator is unmoored. It is at the moment in which the subject is in the picture and they can no longer see themselves. The disappearance of the subject in the moment of the look adds to and enlarges the gaze in analyses of speech, text, and image. It is to maintain the dimension eminent in the encounter with the praying mantis, which Lacan describes in the seminar on anxiety as, quote, "I don't know what object I am," end quote, to the other, with the consequence that you could be devoured. Will I be the object devoured, or will I find a way to go on? At the end of the day, aren't the most interesting films and cases the ones that give a glimpse of a dimension behind the mirror, behind the obvious, and one that is at once uncannily homely and radically alien? There's a reason the alien burst forth at the dinner table in the most ordinary of activities. It is in what lurks and cannot be apprehended imaginarily or even symbolically. It simply is, outside of form, looking and waiting, and into which we can project anything or everything. It makes us very anxious. It can even make us go mad. It's the wolfman's wolves. It's the deadly gaze apprehended by the young homosexual woman in her moment of abandonment by the older woman. It's Oedipus's eyes looking back at him. It's the planet Solaris from the film of the same name. These are privileged moments that break through the visual field, staining it. This is not the usual activity of spectating, as in gazing upon. Just looking momentarily at the etymology of gaze. It's the moment the other looks and we become unmoored. It's an anonymous other. We become moored, unmoored, destabilized, nakedly exposed to another reality that doesn't reflect or offer mediation of drive reality, that simply pulses. From whence creativity and the surprising may be possible. And that's as much as I want to say. I would like, if it's okay with you, to show you a little clip now from the film Solaris. I don't know if you're familiar with it. There are actually two versions of the film. There's, of course, the original masterpiece by Tarkovsky in 1972. And then there's a remake in 2002, which I think not many people have seen, actually. Steve Clooney and Natasha McElhone in the lead roles. I actually think it's very good. It has a lot to offer. It's very different from the original. And I've selected a scene from that 2002 version. And it is, the premise of the film is that there is a ship that has been sent to explore, do some research on this planet Solaris. Very strange things have been happening to the members on board this ship. And the main character is sent up, he's a psychologist, to find out what has been going on with the strange behavior and actions of people on the ship. And the clip I'm going to show you is, it's a scene in which the ship is before the planet Solaris. And I'm simply going to play this, and I'm going to finish with that and be interested to see what you think. Just if I could just maybe finish on this comment, I suppose what I'm suggesting to you here is that the planet Solaris is an interesting representation of the look that is being proposed here, the Lacanian look, this anonymous, disturbing, anxiety-provoking thing before which the subject, in this case, the spaceship, is navigating. And as we know from the film, having very disturbing effects on them. So hopefully you got a sense of it. I'm sorry if the clip didn't play well for you, but it is it's a slow moving clip. And maybe if it was extra slow, that wasn't such a bad thing. So that's it.
And thank you so much for fascinating and insightful educational talk. That's absolutely wonderful. The way we usually run this, those of you who are new to Lacan Scotland, is we now have time for some questions. So we have like half an hour, 45 minutes for questions. I'm going to kick off and then I'm going to open things up to the floor. So if you do have questions, please, if you can put up your Zoom hand rather than your own physical hand, and that helps us identify you, and then we can unmute you and you can ask your question. So I'm just going to start off with a very broad question, Eve, and I know there are other people who are very eager to ask you questions, but just really just following on from your talk and the one example you gave us at the end there, can you say a little bit more about what it is in a film that would identify it for you, at least, as an example of a film that demonstrates the gaze at work? Or if I can put that question in a slightly different way, this idea of the gaze in cinema, is it there in all cinema? Is it something that is there in the experience of cinema, or is it something that particular filmic products bring to the fore? That's the question I'm wondering around. Is that, hopefully that makes some sense.
Well, I suppose how the effect of the gaze is produced in cinema is a technical question. And as we know, for example, from the filming of the shower scene in Psycho, and I gave that as an example of the gaze eminent in the plug hole in the famous shower scene. That shower scene happened because Hitchcock needed to pan the camera and something other than the figure of the dead woman, because she was blinking and the water was making her blink. So it happened by accident, but it produced this really interesting effect. And I'm not a film specialist, and there may be some people here who can speak much better to this than I can about how these things technically, and the cinematography involved and the imagining involved in order to do this is important. But the effect that it creates is a disturbance in the viewer, where the viewer is disturbed from an easy kind of one-to-one relationship with what's unfolding, even if it's difficult to look at, or we want to look away, or whatever. That it's there's something more profound at work happens, such that this is the part of the film that everybody keeps going back to. You know, trying to find some kind of way of representing not just what happened, but the effect itself on the spectator, in this case, on the viewer. So I think we can probably think of many examples of that in film. I mean, I mentioned a few of them. I mentioned the red coat, the little girl with the red coat from Schindler's List. And it falls outside of narrative form. It really can't be squared easily at all with the kind of unfolding of the film, or sort of character logical development and so on. And it's the effect I was trying to draw a parallel with the effect on the reader of Freud's case studies, where would you agree we're not allowed to settle? Freud doesn't let us settle in. Have you ever read a case? I've never read any of the cases where I've put the case down and thought, that's it, I have it. Every single time I read the cases, every one of them, I find something new. I reflect on it differently. Something else is revealed. And I thought Mahoney did a good job of helping us grapple with what's going on. And I like to think that there are elements of that in some films. I mean, it's interesting how today we live in a time where the most popular films, the multi-mega films, are the superhero films, and they're not considered good films. And none of them, except for, I think, the Tom Cruise one, got nominated for the Oscars this year, that there was, people were sort of wondering what's going on with the Oscars in 2023. All of these, quote, art films are being nominated. And it's because the Academy, I think, recognizes that those films will stand the test of time, that there's something going on in these films that can't easily be pinned down. It's very vague way of putting it, but it's up to the individual viewer or spectator to bring some kind of meaningfulness to it. Not even meaning, but some kind of meaning. The spectator, the viewer, the listener is not quite the same afterwards as they were before.
It's something specifically in the visual field that at the same time it isn't contained within the visual field. Mm-hmm. Is that a reasonable way of putting it?
It is. It's an easy one for me to go to because I was there a few weeks ago at the National Gallery in London, standing before the ambassadors as I go every time I go to London, and the anamorphosis, this very extraordinary death's head that's in the bottom of the painting. And when you stand at a particular place, and I actually went with an 11-year-old and a 9-year-old, I was really interested to see what would they make of it. And they were completely perturbed by this. They couldn't understand why it was there. And they didn't at all have the same reaction to that place where you can stand, where the one place where you can stand where the skull is a little bit clearer. And it's always hard to find, and it's never, I don't know, I always struggle with it. But it's that sense that art produces something in the visual field, and in encountering that thing in the visual field, we're no longer in the visual field. As Lacan says, we're in the painting. So we can't separate the objects of the painting or the painting itself.
And there's a kind of hook to the viewer then, that it hooks the viewer in. Mm. In a disturbing way.
That's right. That's right.
I think the example of Holbein is, I think, a fantastic one, not just as a painting. We've all seen it on the cover of Seminar 11, but as you say, when you actually go to see it, that experience, I took a bunch of students to see it some years ago, and it was, I think, works really well in the context of what we're talking about just now, because half the group got it or were got by it, and half the group just were, what? And they couldn't find that place, or that place couldn't find them, and it just didn't work. And I think that's a really important aspect of this, that the gaze may be in the film, but it's only in the film if the film catches you, or if the gaze catches you.
Yes, that's a lovely way of putting it. And I can tell you, the 11-year-old and the 9-year-old I went with were much more captivated by the nudes that they had to pass through in order to see the ambassadors, and were very, very taken aback with that. That's where they were at.
Fantastic. Eve, I'm going to open things up, because I know there are other people who've got who are desperate to ask you questions. And I'm going to start off with Ollie. Ollie.
Thanks, Callum. Hi, Eve, and thank you for a fantastic and really fascinating talk. And I was really pleased to see at the end that you chose the more contemporary version of Solaris rather than the one that's in Todd McGowan's book, because it allowed you to give a different example of the gaze to what he gives for Tarkovsky's Solaris. I want to ask you about something that you said in terms of the dead end, the mastery understanding of the gaze that's explored in Mulvey and Metz takes us down. And to ask you if you think that there's any way to reconcile how Metz and Mulvey conceive of the gaze in the register of the imaginary and informed by the symbolic with how Kopchak and McGowan go on to develop it, because Kopchak and McGowan position themselves as being opposed to the earlier understanding of the filmic gaze in film studies. But I'm not so sure that the two have to remain as separate understandings. So I'd just be interested to know what your view on that is, if you think there is a way to reconcile the real of the McGowan, Kopchak, Zizek understanding of the filmic gaze and the imaginary understanding that's there in Metz and Mulvey.
And their work is excellent, McGowan and Kopchak, and aim, I think, to resuscitate, revitalize the Lacanian gaze against these earlier versions. And I'm not that interested in doing that. And they've done it, and it's excellent. I suppose I'm more interested in what we can learn from. And I think that's your question in some ways. What can we learn from the fact that that this is where it went? And well, I mean, I suppose the first thing we can and this is, I'm not saying anything, I'm sure you don't know, Ollie, is that you know that we these early versions, these film studies and feminist applications of the gaze elided the register of the real. I mean, that's the problem with them, if you want to put it in those terms. So maybe then we can begin to say, well, what is it about the register of the real that is troublesome in other discourses? I mean, it is the register of the real, of course, that distinguishes Lacan's analytic discourse, if you will, and I suppose particularly his later work. A lot of this work took off maybe before or around the time that Lacan was finishing, you know, the 70s. Lacan died in 1981. And his work wasn't widely available. It wasn't available outside of France. So people didn't have access, easy access to Lacan's work. So I think it took a while for that to filter through. And I think that's an important point. You know, we have at that time the importance of postmodernism, deconstructionism, and these approaches that this sort of reading of the gaze, I think, appealed to. And these, you know, I suppose, I mean, this is, I'm not sure how, this isn't very well formulated by me just yet, but I suppose I'm thinking about the importance of minority and identity based discursive analysis, and with that politics, and we can't think of identity if we think about the feminist scholarship, particularly in queer scholarship in relation to film, and how important that has been, and its own way continues to be, maybe a little bit less so now, but that, you know, we can't think of identity outside. Identity is the imaginary register, properly speaking. And so it fit very well within the discursive work at the time. And I think it's very useful to think of it that way, rather than, as I said, poo-pooing, I think was how I put it, consigning you know, this way of working to the waste paper basket of history. I think it's reflective of the ideological emphases and foci at the time, and the question then today is there more room for the Lacanian real in interdisciplinarily? Question. Hi.
That's great, Eve. Thank you.
Thanks, Ollie. Just on the back of that, Eve, I think that's a really important point you make about work like Mulvey's and identity. And I wonder, is part of the problem there, although we're trying to be generous here and say that, you know, let's not poo-poo it, let's not throw the baby out the bathwater, but is part of the problem it's too fixed, that it fixes an identity in a way that needs to be disrupted by the real?
Well, and that's it. I mean, psychoanalytically, it's, you know, desire emerges in the place where identity, well, not identification, fails. It's desire, an unconscious desire, which is what psychoanalysis interests itself in, that's what it's about, is not coincident with identity and identification. Mm-hmm. So therein lies the crux of the problem. It's the moments and the places where identification fails that we are particularly attentive to. And the problem with these discourses is they are very, I suppose, identity-based, you know, and this kind of coincidence between the viewer and what they're seeing, yes, with all kinds of very, very interesting cultural and ideological elaborations, and very, very interesting, but that it's there's a one-to-oneness that's established where's the place where identifications fail? Where's the place for fantasy, unconscious fantasy and so on?
Yeah. Fantastic. Leon. Nice to see you, Liam.
Very nice to see you, and nice to see you, Eve.
Hello,
missed
Leon.
She was in Berlin just a few days ago, and I had a connecting flight from the US, and I just missed the flight, and I missed Eve's talk, and I'm happy I can see her today. And it was a fantastic talk, and I'm looking forward to talk to you about it a bit more, but I'll pose a question.
Well, I missed you on Monday night, and indeed you were missed in the group, but it's lovely to see you this evening. Thank you for coming along.
Naturally. But let me pose this question, and we'll see if you can make an even fascinating answer to it. So you've spoken about the mirror stage, and you know, for Lacan, it is an optical metaphor, right? It is useful for students of psychoanalysis in order to understand what the treatment looks like. And you've mentioned the paper Daniel Lagache, where Lacan really is explicit on that. And particularly, and you also showed that, and I was very interested in this revised schema with the gaze in psychosis, but you've showed that it is also useful in order to identify instances where the gaze can be used to distinguish between different subjective structures, like the neurotic and the psychotic. And, you know, the term male gaze, and this is another axis for Lacan, right? There's the neurotic, psychotic, perverse, and then there's the masculine and feminine. So the male gaze is a term that is actually used, I think, mostly by non-Lacanian scholars. I'm not an expert, but
it's so
many times used in that way. And what I was wondering, if you think that actually the Lacanian distinction between the masculine and feminine subjective structures can also find its bearing in relation to the gaze. So basically, I'm asking if you think that being strictly Lacanian, we can speak about the masculine and the feminine gaze.
Oh, that's a really good question. That's one I could have been doing with a couple of hours ago now, to think about that and to be able to give some kind of a reasonable answer. Thank you, Leon. That's absolutely wonderful. I'm not going to be able to give a good enough answer, but I would say, in answer to your question, yes, there is a distinction, structurally speaking, you could say, between the masculine gaze and the feminine gaze, if we approach it via Lacan's formulae of sexuation. And as he set up a metaphor for sexual difference, is this formulae of sexuation. And I'm aware it may not be familiar to many of you out there. But in that formulae, what's very interesting is Lacan indicates that there's two sides. One side is masculine, that is the left side, and the right side is the feminine side. And they have a relationship to each other, but it's not one of any kind of equivalence. And in fact, the masculine side is the one which is designated the side in which the subject relates to the O object. So that would, I suppose, point us in the direction of whether we can make a connection in this case between the O object as gaze and the masculine side of the formulae masculine structure. And it does seem to be the case that, I mean, it's hard to speak about this without falling into all kinds of sort of stereotypical comments. It was probably going to get me into all kinds of trouble. But it does seem to be the case that when it comes to sexuality, for example, the visual field seems to be much more important to men than it is to women. So, for example, there's a greater propensity of looking at pornography, going to clubs where women perform and so on the side of men. That's a gross generalization. It's not to say women don't do that, but primarily men. So it begs the question, you know, what is it that when it comes to sexual difference, what is it that men are looking for in this, in the visual field, beyond the visual field? So it opens up that question. And that is certainly, I think, an area to be, and the question of looking and size and all kinds of things. This just doesn't seem to matter so much to on the side of women. Maybe it's possible to say that. So those are some initial thoughts that come to mind, Leon. Do you have any thoughts on it yourself?
No, it's just your talk really inspired this question in me. I was like,
it's one for further analysis, isn't it?
Absolutely, yes. It's a date, so
great.
Great question, Leon. I think we're going to have Eve back next year to focus on answering your question at length. So
it's a difficult question.
And it's a very difficult question, but a brilliant question. Maybe we can have you back next year doing a double act. Yeah, that's a date. I wonder, Eve, just sort of picking up on your answer there, you're focusing on the male need for looking, or the male need for the scopic, and does that, would you say that is accompanied on the other side by the historical positioning of women as objects, that women are positioned culturally, in our culture at least, as being the ones to be seen?
Yes, it's impossible to divorce this discussion from that. I think that's a very important point, that women's object status in culture, which is so very well picked up by these by feminist analyses, not just of film, but feminist analyses generally, are very important and very, very good. I suppose the most famous one is probably Catherine MacKinnon, who talked about women being reduced entirely to being sexual objects, culturally speaking, and Andrea Dworkin, who I think whose work is actually becoming more important again. I see there's something of a resurgence of Andrea Dworkin's work on women as objects of sexual violence, for example, and other. She actually has written a great deal beyond that as well. And these are important areas to ponder, I suppose, as we have arrived at a time where we have not at all moved on from gender-based violence. It seems to, if anything, it seems to be on the rise. I mean, the big other we don't think of a kind of social unconscious in the Lacanian field as they do in other fields. But of course, the big other and its cultural influences are going to play a role in how subjectivities are performed, if you will, to be a bit Butlerian about it. Mm-hmm. And maybe even more than that as well, in terms of how ego ideals come to structure the subject, which is a bit late in subjective and structural formation, but very, very important. So the role of culture in ego ideals, and the objectification of women continues to play a role in that way. Yes.
That's
also an important area for further work. Yes.
That's a very important point. I wonder if, bringing about that back to film, do you see female or feminist? I'm not suggesting those two things are the same thing, and you know, the overlapping groups. But do you see female and feminist film makers as being disrupting the gaze in particular ways?
Not necessarily. I'm not sure the Hurt Locker disrupted the female gaze in any kind of way, or what some of the things we've just been referring to. It's a terrific film, but it depends. I mean, part of the problem is I don't know as much about women directors, but I tend to link this more to female performance within film, and maybe certain actors that tend to embody something that goes beyond the visual and that disturbs the viewer. And there are certain performers that seem particularly good at that. I'm thinking in particular of, say, Tilda Swinton. Really, almost everything she puts a hand to is uncomfortable viewing for the viewer, for the spectator, and others too. So, I mean, certainly there are very, very important female directors that I think have, over the last number of years, done some important work in terms of opening up the field of women's sexuality and women's lived experience. The woman that directed the France's Nomadland last year, I think, has done some really interesting work. And I think it's interesting to me that the establishment recognizes this work. It doesn't recognize the work that's actually making money, that's keeping the whole thing going. It's interesting, isn't it?
Absolutely. I mean, it's also a curious reinscription of that division between high and low culture. I think there is... You know, I speak as a big fan of Marvel films. I think they have a lot of richness in them. I don't quite, you know, I don't entirely endorse that split. I think there are different kinds of films, do things in different ways, and you know, even Tilda Swinton likes a Marvel film. So,
right. Yeah, that's true. Yes.
But you know, I think there are things in many films that we don't necessarily want to see or tend to see in that way, but I think you were bang on earlier when you said about there being a particular kind of more art house film that contains that disruptive element that we don't tend to see in more mainstream films. And it is curious, you say, that things like the Academy are embracing those films.
Based on what you've just said, Callum, I mean, because I don't like the Marvel films much, and I don't watch them, but maybe we need to work harder to see elements of you say that they're worth having a look at, that there's elements in these films that are unusual and are open to analysis.
Absolutely.
We need to look a bit harder. Yeah.
Well, I think that's, I think that's very true about film in general. I think there is, you know, film is an interactive experience. You know, we often think of film as, you know, something that is projected up on the screen, or these days on our TV or our laptop. So it's always an interactive experience. So the work of film, like the work of dreams, comes through the interpretation. So in a sense, I think you can put all cinema on a level. It's the work of interpretation that you bring to it that brings the richness out of the film. Some films, I think, lend themselves more easily to that. And sometimes it's the more, what are often perceived as the most challenging films that paradoxically make it easier to get into that interpretive work. Whereas the what are perceived with the blander films actually are more difficult to interpret because they're presented as seamless, and you know, you're engaged in this high speed action and you're not enticed into the same thought processes that you are when you're watching a slower, more obviously meditative art house film. So I think, yeah, we can interpret anything, but there's work to be done.
I'm really glad you said that, and I think I need to open myself up a bit more to these. I also, and I suppose this is my resistance also kicking in at the same time, because I immediately found myself thinking of the work of Cindy Sherman. So I'm hearing you and I'm saying yes, but and I was thinking about the work of Cindy Sherman actually as I was
unconscious is pulling you back.
There it is, indeed.
Okay, we're running short on time here, but I do see a big yellow hand up. So Mark, please come in with a question.
Yes, I enjoyed your talk, and I'm wondering, in this discussion of gender regarding the gaze, I think you made very clear that Mulvey's male gaze theory involves the patriarchal control of women, or at least oppression of women, and the lure of that on screen. But would you say that the Lacanian look coming from the object relates back to the maternal gaze in the sense of how each of us come from a source that we experienced but cannot remember yet strongly influenced us? You know, not just the birth mother, but primary caretaker. Yep. Through that mirror stage, awakening of a sense of self as an illusion in the symbolic and imaginary dimensions, so that the real of the gaze is perhaps for all of us in some sense gendered as maternal in origin, at least. Or am I just speaking more as a male? You said that the focus on objects was from the masculine position. So I'm trying to understand that relationship.
Yes, I think I agree with you, Mark. And that was actually one small aspect of my remarks this evening is with Lacan's development of the optical schema, it allows him to formulate and through this optical metaphor specify not only a pre-verbal look, we are looked into being or looked into life, if we want to put it that way. It's pre-verbal, but it's also pre-specular as well, of course. And that's your right to point to that and its connection to the mother, to the primary caretaker. I suppose the foundational aspect of that sets up what the internalization of this look will then need to be distributed, if you will, through the big other, which will mediate it in a way that will mean that we're not left defenseless, faced with the inchoate drives and so on, which would leave us open, structurally speaking, to psychosis or a psychoticizing experience. But whether that pre-verbal look and that pre-specular look is on the side of whether we can gender that is the big question. And I'm not sure that we can. And I suppose that was one of the reasons why I wanted to give you that clip from the planet Solaris, because it is utterly anonymous without any kind of qualities at all, never mind gender. So I'm not sure I would say that that this, it would be closer, I suppose, to what Freud specified as Das Ding, this thing, and that Lacan returned to in the ethics seminar. And this is the woman, maybe with a capital W, that Lacan refers to as an object around which the drive circulates. But I wouldn't be inclined to genderize this. I think that's not quite what's in play with this, and that would distinguish it from the work of Mulvey and others.
Would it be paradoxically both the beginning and end of life, in the sense of the object gazing back at the subject, because we're all, you know, going to be an object someday, and we start as, you know, a mysterious object, then gaining subjectivity. So is it both is it confrontation of objectivity with our subjectivity? It's also about mortality.
That's an interesting idea. It could be. I'd have to think about it some more.
Well, your example of Solaris, both versions, and you know, also the clip you showed made me think about that, the kind of animated generation, planet that reads our dreams and generates them into materiality, but that's a haunting, ghost-like presence.
Well, does it read them, or is it so empty and devoid of anything other than presence that we can project onto it anything at all? And what we'll project onto it is usually what's troubling us. And that's, I think, isn't it very nicely portrayed in the film? Have you seen the later version, Mark?
I still like the Tarkovsky one better. Original. But maybe I'll have to reconsider the Soderbergh
one. Oh, no, I wouldn't dream of saying the later one is better, but be shot for saying something is better than Tarkovsky, but it's pretty good.
No, but what strikes me with Tarkovsky's version especially, I guess it's in the original story, that the main character is getting what he most desires, what he most misses, his lost wife. And yet that's what's so terribly troubling, and he has to destroy her because she's not what's in his memory.
Yes,
she's false in some way, and yet she could be real. So it's also that problem of the other, a person in our lives that we invest so much in, that we care about and love, that then becomes a fantasy and is often, you know, confronting us with other aspects of that person's character that is not part of our fantasy. So that the problem of, you know, loving the wrong person, or loving the fantasy. Which I think you're right. I think film, in a lot of the time, most of the time, maybe because it's entertainment medium, is giving us fantasies, but the best films challenge us with that problem in our fantasy.
Yeah, it is. It's a nightmare for the protagonist when his wife returns. I don't want to say maybe too much to spoil it for those who haven't seen it, but it's the fantasy object that is the desired object, and the real object in this case does not coincide with the desired object. She did at one point, but not anymore. We can see the same problem arise for Scotty in Vertigo. This is the problem for him. It's a very nice way of the film. I'm very interested in vertigo and how the object cause of desire on the side of masculine structure, Leon, is rendered in the film, and how this is this does not work out at all for Scotty, but it is his obsession, but the object cause, the O object made flesh, is a great disappointment, and he spends such moments doing everything he can to try and arrange her so that she can somehow meet with these points of his desire, but of course she can't. No.
Well, maybe it's also partly why, as you were mentioning, film studies has neglected the real in the Lacanian theory, and even, you know, pushed aside the psychoanalytic approach because it's too challenging.
Maybe, yeah.
But thanks for reminding us about it.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. It's a nice place to end as well. We like a challenge. Eve, thank you so much for a fantastic talk and a very generous discussion. You've given us all lots to think about. You've given us some very good suggestions to go off and read, and things to go off and watch. So it's been an incredibly enriching evening. Thank you very much.
I hope we will have you back
sometime.
It would be my pleasure, and thank you for your hosting, and thanks to the group for your provocative questions. I have gone away with several things to ponder, significantly to ponder, I think. So thank you very much for that.
Great. And thank you, everyone else, for coming along this evening. We have our final Lacan Scotland session of the academic year, so the final session before the summer, at the end of May, which will be with Matt Flissfeder. So please do join us for that. Knowing Matt's work, I think it's going to be an absolutely fantastic talk. So it'll be great to see you all there. And then we will pick up again in September with Dominic Hones. And we already have quite a rich season set up for next year, so please do stay with us. Thanks for joining us this evening. Hopefully see you soon.